Domain-driven design is a design standard to develop complex software in a modular, scalable, and loosely coupled way, following the best practices in terms of separation of concerns. And it was created by Eric Evans and presented in his 2003 book, Tackling Complexity in the Heart of Software. Very quickly, a domain model is the richest possible comprehension of processes, policies, and rules inside the domain, and is described by an ambiguous language which is created by the domain experts and the developers in order to translate a normalized and modeled vision of the domain. It's also the very first step in order to conceive a canonical perspective of this specific core domain. Depending on the problem we are trying to solve or the system complexity, we might need to address other related domains, which will be called bounded contexts. Each bounded context will probably need to have its own ubiquitous language, which it means that we can end up with several different canonical models. Context maps is basically the relationship between different bounded contexts, and the very existence of a bounded context anticipates the need to have a process of continuous integration between, in this case, the core domain and the bounded context to guarantee model integrity, which will help keeping the model properly unified. There are many different communication partnerships between bounded contexts. For instance, the customer supplier went to teams where one plays the customer role in the core domain side, downstream as the client, and another plays the supplier role. The supplier domain feeds the client. However, the client has some capacity to influence and negotiate through proper acceptance testing, interface negotiation, and by keeping a tight continuous integration process. The shared kernel is another approach where two teams agree to share the responsibility to manage a shared context. This shared context might contain a specific subset of the model, code, or data. Any change must be synchronized between the teams in some way, and this can be kind of challenging to manage. But very often this approach tends to reduce duplicated libraries and superfluous code. The conformist model is another approach of the customer supplier. It's a kind of customer supplier relationship where the customer has limited or no capacity at all to influence or negotiate. In this case, the best path is to try to be conformant with the supplier upstream model and hope for the best, as the customer completely depends on supplier good intentions. Then, and finally, the anti-corruption layer. In this case, if the downstream customer doesn't completely trust the upstream supplier, a solution might be to introduce an intermediary anti-corruption layer, in this case because the cost or risk to get the core domain model break is too high to assume. Okay, this is achievable through translation and proper mapping. Then, implementation patterns. To implement the different communication partnerships, we need implementation patterns. And simplistically, we can apply three different implementation patterns. RPC, where the core domain will basically rely on the service registry to find the service, which will provide then some data from the bounded context. The service registry keeps information on where to call the bounded context service and how to call it as well through a proper contract such as WSL, for instance, which will describe the service if we are talking about SOAP. The second implementation pattern is messaging, and in this case, an event can be defined as a fact that occurs inside our core domain representing a significant change in state, which in this case is relevant to the bounded context. And the third and final implementation pattern is REST, and in this case typically it describes the utilization of HTTP to obtain data by executing CRUD operations in formats based on XML or JSON. So, wrapping up, we have been talking about domain-driven design with an objective in mind, which is to understand its importance when discussing distributed architectures and microservices in particular. A microservices architecture consists in composing systems with bounded, isolated components. Each microservice should constitute a proper business capability. Business capabilities, though exposed through an API layer, will internally translate the consumption of a self-contained and a centralized service with its own data source or database. Any relevant state changes could imply triggering domain events from a bounded context to another bounded context. I hope it got clear now to you that domain-driven design principles respond to the most basic needs of complex distributed architectures, including microservices. How to implement this is something we are going to find out on the next episode of this series. Thank you very much.